Indeed. Hallelujah. We welcome you to worship on this, the third Sunday of Easter, as we celebrate the continuing celebration of Jesus' resurrection. We welcome each and every one of you, knowing that none of us are here by accident. We are all here by God's design. So we want to give a special welcome to all those who might be here for the first time or who have started recently coming or perhaps might even be stopping in while on vacation. Welcome, because you and I, we are all here by God's design. We welcome also those who are on our live stream today. We want to, our prayer is always that you will be blessed and that God will join us together in our hearts and our worship. And so we have a few announcements for you today. First of all, we want to show you our Connect code. This QR code, you can hold up your phone to it, open up the camera app, and it will prompt you that, do you want to follow this? Go to our website. And if you choose the top option in there, you can sign our online Connect card, our welcome card. It is one way that we get to celebrate your worship with us. And also, it is a way that you can be communicating with us that you are worshiping and you desire some prayer. So you can use that. Especially if you are new or newer here, we invite you, you could use that paper card in the pew rack in front of you. That is our welcome card, that gold card there. And I'll say just a little bit about that in a second. We want to highlight that we have begun a new parents group, a Christian parent support group and Bible study happening during the Sunday school hour. So if you are a parent or if you are a godparent or if you are a grandparent, anyone could join this, but especially we're wanting to engage parents in our Sunday school whose kids are in Sunday school. The topic is unselfie, and it is living in this world as someone who is empathetic in a world in which people are all about themselves. And so we invite people to join that. Also, we want to highlight coming up next Sunday is what we call our pastor's reception. This is especially designed for people who are newer or new-ish to Prince of Peace, and it's a way that you can learn a little more about Prince of Peace, Principe de Paz. It's a way that you can go deeper or understand here are some pathways for you to connect or be engaged more. And it is also an opportunity to find out about membership, the process here at Prince of Peace, Principe de Paz. That is April 21st, next Sunday, 2 p.m. And we want to highlight that building community is an important thing here at Prince of Peace. Jim Essig, our director of senior adult ministry, is he creates events that help connect people. And so we have this lunch and zilch event happening on Thursday, April 25th, and we invite you to that. RSVPs are important for that so that we can prepare enough food for people to come to that. And then Fine Concert Series, another opportunity for you to come, for you to invite others to be a part of it. Sunday, April 28th, 4 p.m., connecting with them as their high school band, concert band, and choir join us on Sunday, April 28th. Today, as we continue talking about God raising courage up within us, we're talking about the courage to be bold. And with that, it's time for us to welcome one another, so I invite you to stand and greet each other in Christ's name.
Our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Trusting in God's promise, let us confess our sins. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shatter the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, abound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and the hungry and pass by those who mourn. We are deaf to the cries of the oppressed and indifferent to the calls for peace. We despise the weak and abuse the earth you made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life, abundant giving in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, hear the good news. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, all our sins have been forgiven. We are washed clean by the blood of Christ, the Lamb, and are renewed and restored as the children of God. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with boldness and courage, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
The first lesson for this third Sunday of Easter is from the third chapter of Acts. While the lame man who is now healed held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power of godliness, we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, then, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Heaven must receive him until the time comes for God to restore everything as he promised long ago through his holy prophets. This is the word of the Lord. The second lesson is from 1 John chapter 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him or know him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything to eat here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witness of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
At this point, we'd love to invite children present to come forward. Got a few kiddos. So I brought something with me today. I brought a trophy. Can you guys tell me something that somebody might win a trophy for?
Swimming.
Okay. You got a trophy for swimming? Congratulations.
Also
for dancing. Could win a trophy for dancing. Can you think of some other things? Gymnastics. So you're thinking sports, right? You're thinking sports. You know, this trophy I won here was actually, believe it or not, I won a photography contest. Do I look like an artist?
No.
Yeah, you can win trophies for all sorts of things, right? Now, who gets the trophy? Who gets the trophy? The person who won? Okay. And maybe like second or third place might get one too. How about if you come in last? Yeah, probably not. These days we give out lots of trophies, but oh, yeah. We don't always get to win, right? But if we do, it would be very cool to win a trophy, right? So if we had, let's say we went outside and did a race. Who thinks they would win if we went outside and had a race? You think you would? You think you can beat everybody here? You beat all of them? You know what? I love the confidence. So let's say we did go out and have a race. And you did win, just like you said. And I said, "Here's a trophy," and I gave it to your sister instead. How would you like that? You like the person who wins should get the trophy, right? Well, you know what? The thing that's so great about Easter is that Jesus, on the cross, defeated death and won the victory. And he said, "You know what? You get the prize. I defeated sin and death, and because of it, you get the prize. You get to come and live with me forever in heaven. You get your sins forgiven. You get the prize." Jesus didn't keep the prize all for himself, but he gave it to us. And so should we go out and tell the world that we get to go to heaven because we won? Or do we tell the world that we get to go to heaven because Jesus won? Right? Jesus won. So it's really, really important that we know that God loves us so much that he gave us eternal life. But when we tell the world about that, we tell them the reason that we get to go to heaven is because Jesus won. Not because of anything that we did to earn it, but because Jesus loves us so much and he won the victory and he gives us eternal life. And so I would love for you to join me praying right now. And we're going to thank Jesus for sharing his victory with us so that we get the prize, okay? If you guys would fold your hands and pray with me, or repeat after me so we can pray together. Dear Jesus, thank you for winning the victory over death and sin and giving me eternal life. Help me tell the world that your victory is for them too. Amen.
Thank you so much, Eric, and congratulations on that trophy. Yay! Did he say calligraphy? Is that what you said, calligraphy?
Photography.
Photography. Oh, okay. Because I've seen your handwriting. That's where I just missed it for a second there. Photography. Now, that I believe, though. That I believe. Grace and peace be yours from Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. And as Jesus has been raised from the dead, he also raises us up to new life in him. And so our theme for this period of the church year, this Easter season, is that our God is resurrecting courage in us. That is our prayer, that he would do so. Why? Well, it's hard. It's challenging for us to simply be authentic people of God in this world today, I believe, because people don't care about that. And so they put it down, or they ignore it, or maybe discard or discount it. But you and I are called to be just who we are, just who God has declared us to be. In the second lesson today, it talked about how we are children of God. That is who we are. And so as we live out our faith, how do we do so in ways that are courageous? And today we look at bold. We have been circling, or we will circle last week, this week, and next week around this event in the life of the apostles in Acts chapter 4, chapter 3, where they heal a man who is born lame. Some of the backstory, some of the context. Peter and John are going up to the temple to pray. They're going there, as is the custom. And there's a man who has been brought there every day. People know who he is. He is not able to walk. This disabled beggar is there because he's expecting or hoping to receive some sort of charity from people. He does not have the ability to go out and work because of this disability. And we find out that he is over 40 years old. So people are familiar with this guy. And as Peter and John are going into the temple, this man looks at them, and he's begging anyone and everyone who comes by. But Peter looks straight at him. Acts chapter 3, verse 4. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." In other words, give me your full attention. I've got something here that you need to hear. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." And taking the man by his right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk, and then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. This man who has been healed is everything that is bold. He's not behaving as you would normally behave when you go to church. Instead, he's praising God for coming into his life and changing it. I like to say this phrase many times. Maybe some of you will adopt it. That we're here because God desires to change lives here and for all eternity. He doesn't simply want to give us an eternal future. You know, someday we'll get to heaven, so now what do we do? Instead, he changes our lives. He comes into our world, Jesus does, so that he might change the world. He changes our lives by changing everything. For this man who is healed, that changed everything. How does God want to be at work in you and in me? What does he want to transform in us? How will you stay close to Jesus so that he will rub off on you and his glory and his love will become a part of the fabric of your life? So Peter and John, they see this remarkable miracle, as do everybody else. And the people are filled with wonder and amazement, it says, because of what had happened to this man. And then verse 11, which is properly the scripture lesson that was read earlier, it says that this man was hanging on to Peter and John. And as he was hanging on to them, the people come storming around. They want to see what's happened. They want to know what's happened. They want to be a part of what's happened. And so Peter says, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk?" In other words, you shouldn't be surprised to see God at work in our world. You shouldn't be surprised to see that God cares about people and that he is a God of action. And you should not be looking at us, Peter says, as if there was something about us that affected this change in this man by our own holiness or our own godliness or our own power. Now, I would say here, Peter is being bold. First of all, he's bold because he could just pass that beggar by. He could ignore what God is stirring up in his spirit as he sees that man and he knows that God wants him to act. And it could have been easy, perhaps, for Peter to just keep on going. We're supposed to go inside and preach. It could have been easy for Peter to say, "I don't have anything." Have you ever said that to somebody? "I don't carry cash, so I can't give any cash out. I used to work in the neighborhood of North St. Louis in a small ministry there, worked one summer, and they told me, always carry cash." You know why that was? If I would get mugged, I'd have something to give. God has given us more than we could ever carry. And so Peter gives something to this man with great boldness. Something that doesn't cost money, that money can't perform or perfect, he gives to this man, Jesus. When he says, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus." Jesus, the Messiah from Nazareth, walk. I would say that this took boldness on Peter's part also, because at least in our day and age, perhaps you are a little like me. What if this doesn't work? What will they think? But what's Peter been through? Think about it. Peter, just weeks before, had denied Jesus. "I know nothing about that man," and had been restored by Jesus. After Jesus had risen from the dead, "Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep." Peter had experienced the Holy Spirit as he received the Spirit coming at Pentecost, and Peter had seen how simply by opening his mouth and letting God use him as a mouthpiece, speaking about Jesus, thousands of people came to faith. Do you have the boldness of Peter? You don't have to be like Peter. You need to be you as a child of God. However, we probably do need to pray, "God, use me. I'm available to you. Help me to see the opportunities that you put right in front of me every single day. and give me the courage to leave behind my agenda, leave behind my schedule, leave behind my thoughts about what people might think about me, and help me, Lord, simply to be open to you using me in whatever moment there might be. I had a friend, his name was also Ken. Ken Lee was his name, and he was a very bold man, courageous, and I wasn't exactly like him. He was a member of a church that I was serving, but he was very faithful in understanding when God was tapping him on the shoulder and saying, go. So one day, Ken was in a cafe or something, and he felt God prompting him to go over to somebody and to simply say, I feel like God is telling me to pray for you. And the person's eyes welled up as they said, I'm going through, I think it was a divorce or something, and they felt all alone, like everyone, including God, had forgotten them. And that simple act of going, walking up to, and sharing Jesus by saying, I'm supposed to pray with you, opened up the door for this person to receive God's grace and his refreshing love in that moment. You and I, we might be here in this place, and God might tap us on the shoulder. We see someone that maybe we haven't seen for a while, or we think to ourselves, I wonder what's going on in that person's life, or maybe we just feel prompted by God. Maybe we see a new face. You and I are God's ambassadors. He desires to be at work in us and through us, just like he was with Peter, who was available to God in that moment, faithful to God in speaking, and bold to trust in God for God to act, not necessarily him, simply being a conduit of God's love. And so Peter, in this speech, he says, fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk? And then he goes into detail about who Jesus is and all that has happened. And he makes it personal, even to the point of saying, you handed him over to be killed. You disowned him. You killed the author of life, and we're witnesses of this. Maybe we can be personal in a slightly different way. I think you're longing for something more. You want to know whether this is real. You want to know if God has power to be at work in your life, to touch your heart. And so Peter gives the invitation, repent, that your sins may be wiped out and times of refreshing may come from the Lord. You know, there's something that everyone needs, to be refreshed by the Lord. In this world where our energy, our time, our life is drained away by so many different things, you and I need to be refreshed by the Lord. How much more so than somebody who does not have regular contact with God through prayer, God working in their lives through his word, God touching their lives through the power of baptism, being connected with Jesus, or receiving Christ in his body and blood at the altar. How much more do people in our world need to be refreshed? You and I are people who go to refresh others with the word of Jesus, with the love of Jesus, with the peace of Jesus, that which we have received. And he gives us the strength, the courage, the boldness to share that love. And if you simply trust him, watch what he does. Changing lives here and now and for all eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise as we sing.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. You may be seated. Grant humility to your church, O God, that we honor the testimony of those who seem unlikely witnesses to your work. Remove from us all prejudice, opening us to wisdom that challenges and extends more widely the church's ministry. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless the earth and bring forth its increase. Rescue lands from famine and disease. Send aid to places rebuilding after earthquakes and storms. Support the work of scientists, conservationists, and all who seek to preserve the goodness of your creation. Lord, in your mercy, nation rises against nation, O God, even as we pray for your peace. Bring an end to international conflicts and religious persecution. Ensure fair and equitable treatment in courts of law. Give integrity to legislators and those who enforce the law. Lord, in your mercy, show us the depths of your mercy through the work of caregivers, advocates, and healthcare workers. Give strength to patience to those who accompany others through times of illness, uncertainty, or pain. Bring your saving health to those in need, especially David Marion Alt, Jim Lord, Gail Eaton, Brianna Fernandez, Barbara Conyers, Baby Roland, Sloan Davies, Mike Fleming, Judy Finney, Pete Spudich, Larry Cruz, Dennis Glander, Norma Poultry, Bill Jordan, Pat Williams, Denny O'Neill, Joe Hines, Jeff Powell, and Mary Kreplin. Guide us to offer hospitality, shelter, friendship, and care to any in need. Lord, in your mercy, we thank you for the gifts of food, water, and nourishment. Bless farmers and restaurant workers, bakers and grocery store workers, food pantry volunteers, and family members who cook daily meals. Encourage us to share food with those who are hungry that they regain their strength. Lord, in your mercy, in the company of your saints, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your eternal mercy and love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. And now we worship our Lord with the gathering of our tithes and offerings.
Lost God in the darkness. I was lost God, but you were looking for me. When you turned the light on my poor blind eyes began to see. I was lost, God, in the silence. I was lost, God, but you were singing a song. When I heard the music, I just had to try to sing along. Much more. I know you. In the light now, I know you, and I'm beginning to see. You're opening my eyes, and you are making the song out of me.
Please rise. We continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As Jesus taught his disciples to pray, so we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may be seated.
And I invite the choir to come up to commune first, as you are able, so that we can then lead the congregation in the singing of our communion song.
Thank you.
we sing together, Bread of Life from Heaven.
Please rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Go out now in faith and with courage, trusting in God's promises. Remember how much God loves this world and loves you. Live and serve with love and joy, following in the footsteps of Christ. May the Lord watch over you. May the Lord keep you from all harm and watch over your life. May the Lord watch over your coming and your going now and forevermore. Amen. Risen Lord.
Thanks be to God.